In tonight's forum, we talk about the underground system of cash that makes the world go round, untaxed, often illegal, and generally invisible. You should have all received some note cards and pencils on your way in. These are for the Hammer Forum question and answer period for you to write your questions on. When we get closer to the Q&A, we'll send around ushers to collect your cards and bring them up to the stage. If you didn't get a note card or you need some extras, you can just raise your hands and we'll send an usher to bring you more. Please be sure to write your questions very clearly so we can read them out loud for our guest speakers to address. So now I'd like to introduce our moderator, Ian Masters, who will introduce our panelists. Ian is a BBC-trained broadcast journalist who's covered national security affairs for over 25 years on public radio. He's the host of The Daily Briefing every Monday through Thursday at 5, as well as Background Briefing on Sundays at 11, all on KPFK 90.7 FM. Ian has been a senior fellow at UCLA's Center for Strategic and International Affairs and the UCLA Center for International Relations, and was a consultant to the Center for National Security Studies at Los Alamos Laboratory in New Mexico. Please join me in welcoming Ian Masters.
Thank you, Claudia, and thank all of you for coming tonight. After filing your tax returns and writing your checks to the IRS, as you may know, this week House Republicans will vote to reward America's richest families from paying taxes on the fortunes they inherit. And the legislation wouldn't just eliminate the estate tax, the change would significantly alter the meaning of the capital gains tax, since capital gains taxes only hit the wealthy when they actually sell an asset. The 1% of the 1% will be able to keep their wealth in the stock market and pass it down from generation to generation without ever being taxed. Why is Congress on the path to creating a permanent class of Americans who never have to work or pay taxes? And why is America moving closer to becoming an aristocracy of inherited wealth, where your lot in life will be determined more by the family you're born into instead of your hard work and creativity? It may have something to do with the influence of money in our elections as our democracy heads towards a plutocracy away from the meritocracy the Founding Fathers envisioned. What has this got to do with hidden, untaxed offshore money? A lot, because the same global system of hiding the ill-gotten gains of kleptocrats, criminals, dictators, and drug cartels also hides the money of millionaires and billionaires who are avoiding taxes, not to mention giant multinational corporations who park their profits offshore. And by the way, income inequality is not just an American problem, it's increasing globally at an alarming rate. 5 years ago, 388 billionaires had wealth equal to 50% of the bottom half of all people on this planet. Today, half of the wealth of all humanity is in the hands of only 85 billionaires. A system that concentrates wealth in the hands of a few shortchanges the many. And just before you dismiss me as a commie committing class warfare, during the halcyon days of the American dream, when the US economy was the engine of the world, under a Republican president, Dwight David Eisenhower, the wealthiest Americans paid 92% of their income in taxes. Now it is down to 20% or nothing if the so-called death tax is repealed. James Henry will start us off with an overview of the global underground economy, then Zorka Milin will offer some specific examples of the price we all pay from the laundering of dirty and untaxed money into the global financial system. Then we'll have a discussion followed by extensive Q&A. James Henry is an economist, lawyer, and investigative journalist, and former chief economist at McKinsey & Company. He is an Edward R. Murrow Fellow at Tufts University's Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy and Inspire Fellow at its Institute for Global Leadership. He was the lead researcher on the Tax Justice Network's recent report, The Price of Offshore Revisited, and is the author of The Blood Bankers. Ladies and gentlemen, James Henry.
Well, I'm delighted to be here tonight and to on tax day. Progressive income tax is a, fundamentally American tradition. 1913 was the first one. And it was really a response to a progressive movement that developed in the 1890s and the first decade of the 20th century in response to the first Gilded Age. Now we're in the middle of a second Gilded Age. And I think as yet we have no similar kind of response to report, but hope springs eternal, especially in California. So I want to talk to you a little bit about a subject that's near and dear to my heart, the underground economy. I've been working on this topic for 40 years and have dealt with it in all kinds of different dimensions. Tax dodging is only one aspect of it. It also embraces topics like capital flight, and drug traffic, fraudulent finance. All of these things have seen experienced an explosion during the period of globalization since the 1980s. Transnational crimes of all kinds have undergone tremendous expansion. So I'm going to talk about five or six of those. Bear with me, I have a lot of slides. These will be available on the website, so you don't try to write everything down. We'll go pretty quickly. But I want to talk about several pathologies of globalization and of the attributes of the global underground economy. The basic themes here that I want you to take away from this is that we've seen an explosion in the so-called global haven industry since the 1980s, proliferation of so-called tax havens, treasure islands, secrecy jurisdictions that are, some of which are offshore, some of which are onshore, all over the world, going from about 10 or 15 in 1970 to more than 90 now. We've also seen an explosion in what I call kleptocracy, which is basically public officials helping themselves to public assets and diverting, making use of their positions to do so. Worldwide governments are now spending about $9.5 trillion. We estimate that about 5% of that is being diverted to private ends. Pirate banking is an activity engaged in by some of the largest banks in the world. You've probably been reading about the HSBC case. But there's every major bank has its international private banking department specializing in the kind of dubious activity of helping very wealthy people, kleptocrats as well, and some of the world's worst criminals take their money offshore, anonymize it, put it beyond the reach of taxation and regulation. And that's called pirate banking. We estimate that at least $25 trillion of financial wealth, privately owned, is now sitting offshore, costing us about $300 billion a year of lost tax revenues, and exaggerating the impact of wealth inequality, which we already know has been growing dramatically. A third aspect of this is multinational tax dodging. Companies like Google and Microsoft and Apple have been parking their intellectual property offshore, paying themselves royalties tax-free. That's costing us, on a worldwide basis, something like $200 billion a year. But it also involves, and we'll go through a detailed example, for the banana industry, many ordinary commodity trading companies that are engaged in the same activity of exploiting this global haven industry to move their assets beyond the reach of taxation and regulation. This has also helped to ignite what I call a corporate crime wave. I'll try to detail here the extent to which the world's top 22 banks have been engaged in all kinds of misbehavior, 14 different categories of criminal activity since 2000, adding up to a grand total of more than $246 billion of fines, none of which seem to have affected their behavior at all. We want to look at why that is. One of the reasons is that they are enabling this activity is that it's a very profitable and lucrative business, not only for them, but also the world's largest accounting firms and law firms. Finally, we've also seen a surge of human flight from places that people can no longer stand to live. I was just recently in Haiti, which is an example of such a country, where the Haitian diaspora now is supporting, basically providing more than a third of the GDP of Haiti through their remittances that they're sending back home. But they're having to pay 10% of the remittances that are sent to Western Union and a cartel of banks, which is unregulated. So that's another aspect of this, a byproduct of failed development. The last problem I think we see here, and as a result of the global haven industry and a key trend in the world economy, is the rise of tax competition among countries. And fundamentally, that has undermined progressive taxation around the planet. So we really need to have take kind of another look at whether we really think fair taxation is important to us as a society, because at the moment the United States is no longer has a progressive tax system. In fact, the bottom half of the population is paying more in taxes than the top 10%. You've been reading about this in the headlines. I've been, the HSBC and other cases. One typical response on the part of some of the companies that have been involved is that a lot of our activities were, strictly speaking, legal. They're not against the law if they fall in the gray zone of activity. But we have here a whole industry that is specialized in designing tax laws, in being fairly, with an IRS code that now has for corporate tax about 70,000 pages of regulations, the line between tax evasion and tax avoidance is, or tax dodging, is one that you can pretty much determine as a result of how much you're willing to spend. I'm focusing a lot of my effort in this arena on trying to get numbers, and we find that it's very important for us to have as precise an estimate of the size of the underground activity and how fast it's been growing. If you as Lord Kelvin said, if you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. I'm not really sure I agree with him, but I do think it has been helpful for us to put effort into quantifying the importance of these activities, and the results that we've obtained are pretty dramatic. So this is an exercise in what we call investigative economics. It starts with puzzles, and some of the puzzles we tried to solve are date back to the 1970s. My first look at this was when I identified the fact that there were an enormous amount of $100 bills outstanding, far more than we could account for in the domestic economy based on ordinary transactions demand. Well, that has continued to be a factor. The world's most important economies basically are providing what we call big bills to the global underground economy, to the tune now of about $1.8 trillion of big bills outstanding. This policy, which is not only the United States, but also the ECB, the Eurozone countries, and Switzerland and Canada, in fact, basically providing big bills that most people never see or have any use for. Spain is one of the biggest consumers of these bills. In the 1970s, when I took a look at this for the Federal Reserve, we found that much of the currency was flowing in from Colombia and from Mexico and was related to drug traffic. Today, we find the same thing with respect to drug traffic flowing from North Africa into Spain, where the 500 euro note, more than 25% of them are being issued in Spain to facilitate this underground activity. Again, it's a policy that just doesn't have to be, but the European Central Bank, as well as the Federal Reserve in the United States, has continued to facilitate this kind of underground activity. One of the first investigations I did following up on the currency and flowing into Florida's banks was to take a look at Panama's drug dictator, Manuel Noriega. I went to Panama in the late 80s and got access to a complete list of the general's phone calls for 3 years. And that was later a lead piece of evidence in the trial of Noriega in Miami. He was convicted and sentenced to 30 years in prison, just recently been released. At that time, I thought as an investigative journalist, I was doing God's work. It was, breaking up the drug cartel was a great thing, and we were going after this corrupt dictator. What we saw, though, as a result of decartelization was basically, as you would expect really from any market that is decartelized, is a total collapse of price controls as a result of taking Noriega and other players like Pablo Escobar out of the market, and a proliferation of drug traffic throughout Central America and Mexico, to the point where the traffic really exploded as a result of that. So furthermore, I learned in the process of doing this investigation that the Cali cartel had actually been behind the scenes helping to provide me with phone call records. It actually made, at the end of the day, it made for a different kind of conclusion. U.S. drug policy and the underground economy has helped to create that industry, but the policy has been an utter failure. A second aspect of the underground economy that I have studied in some detail is what happened to all the money that was loaned to developing countries during the 1980s. We examined the loans that were sent to 8 different developing countries. I don't have time to go through every one of those, but the same basic pattern existed. We found that the global haven industry was in existence there to facilitate the outflow of the capital flight that was financed by these loans. One of the cases I was involved in was to take a look at the case of Ferdinand Marcos's central bank, where he had borrowed more than $7 billion from New York banks. His central bank had done the borrowing, and then all the money was routed directly offshore to the Swiss accounts of himself and his cronies. So the Philippines ended up owing the debt, but there was no assets to show for to repay it. In fact, the Philippines has continued to service that $7 billion debt. It's about a third of the, it's grown to be about a third of the total foreign debt of the Philippines. Similar kind of story applied to the Argentine foreign debt, where the military was involved in basically running up the debt, by a factor of four during the 8 years that they were in office. At the same time, the elites basically took all their money out of the country. So the total stock of foreign assets today, if you look at Argentina, owned by wealthy Argentines, is more than $400 billion. Far more than the foreign debt. This is a pattern that shows up again and again for the developing world. The problem is not foreign debt. The problem is that their elites have taken the money out of the country and they can't be taxed. So it's really a tax problem and an international problem. It's not one that can be solved just one country by on its own. So I've done odious debt investigations looking at where the money went in more than 24 countries now, and the similar patterns have showed up time and again. At the end of all this, with the developing world in crisis, you had what we call odious privatizations. And here, the most glaring example is the one that we're paying the price for now. In Russia, in 1996, 1995, 96, they privatized 150,000 state companies for a grand total of $9.7 billion, basically lending the money to a select group of oligarchs to buy those all of the assets of the Soviet state. We've ended up today with Russia that's basically an oligarchy and dominated by one guy as a result of that policy. And I think it's fine for us to blame Putin for all that, but really it was the policies in the 90s and the kind of development policy that we permitted that have contributed to that result. Pirate banking is, as we said, the activity of taking money out and setting up offshore accounts. Our estimate of $20 trillion in 2013 got quite a bit of attention from The Economist. We estimated that number in three different ways. I won't go through all the gory details. But since then, the number is, if anything, increased. Our estimate now is that it's on the order of 25 to 35 trillion offshore, partly reflecting the growth of stock markets since 2010, when the first estimate was released. That's leaving out another $5 to $7 trillion of offshore real estate, gold, and other non-financial assets that are held through offshore companies. So this activity is also facilitated by the world's largest banks. As of year-end 2010, the top 10 banks, UBS, Credit Suisse, Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, and so forth, in this market accounted for $6 trillion of the $12 trillion that the top 50 banks accounted for. So they're a major player in this dodgy business. From a developing world standpoint, about a third of the offshore capital, private wealth, is held by residents of developing countries. Largest players are Russia and China. Brazil, Latin America is also fairly substantial as well. Again, when we add those numbers up and compare them to the country debts, we find that all of these countries are basically net creditors of rich countries, to the tune in collectively of about $10 trillion. From the standpoint of the global wealth distribution, this phenomenon of offshoring of private wealth is, I think, one of the most important realities that we have to face. It turns out that the top 100,000 people on the planet collectively own more than $30 million net worth each, own about at least half of all the offshore wealth and more than 30% of all net financial wealth. And the top 10 million people on the planet really account for almost all of the offshore wealth entirely. So as Brecht said, it is capitalism that is truly radical. That kind of concentration of wealth is, if anything, only getting worse during this, during the last 5 years. One more topic here that I want to talk about quickly before we move on is just the epidemic of global multinational tax dodging that's gone on. And I have an example from the banana industry that you might find interesting. Everybody eats bananas, but you might want to understand, when you're buying a banana, how little profit the suppliers of the banana cartel that's engaged in this industry, how little tax they pay by virtue of using this global haven industry. So we start off with a banana that's produced in Latin America, let's say Ecuador, export price of 20 cents a pound, pays maybe a little bit tax in the home country, not much, 1.5%. They set up the company that's exporting, in this case Chiquita, set up a subsidiary in the Cayman Islands that handles their purchasing network. That subsidiary is a wholly owned subsidiary, and they charge the parent 12 cents per pound for that. They set up a Luxembourg subsidiary for financial services that charges another 12 cents per pound. An Ireland subsidiary that charges for the use of the brand. An Isle of Man subsidiary charges for insurance services. And a Isle of Jersey subsidiary charges 6p for management services. And Bermuda, for the distribution network, charges 26 cents per pound. So by the time this is consumed in, say, the UK, the import price of 91 cents has been completely, all of the profits associated with this has been digested by the wholly owned subsidiaries of the banana companies at prices that, who can say whether they're arm's length prices at all? Now, this is not at all unusual for international trade. More than 60% of international trade now goes through captive subsidiaries. And the use of this kind of pervasive network is for soaking up the profits and avoiding taxation is one of the most egregious examples of commodity transfer pricing abuse that we see. So I'm going to leave it there and turn it over to a global witness. But we can come back to these topics later. We have a lot more to talk about tonight. So thanks very much.
Thank you, James. Zorka Milin is an experienced international tax lawyer working as a senior legal advisor with Global Witness, an international investigative and advocacy nonprofit organization. She's also currently serving as a visiting fellow at Yale University's Global Justice Program and with the Information Society Project at Yale Law School, and sits on the board of the Academic Stand Against Poverty Network. She's originally from Serbia and has practiced international tax law for 6 years with two major global law firms. She frequently speaks on transparency, grand corruption, and tax justice. Ladies and gentlemen, Zorka Milin.
So, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Ian, for inviting me to speak here today, and thank you to the organizers, Claudia and Darren, who made the visit possible, and also to Jim Henry for an amazing presentation. So, I'll start by saying a few words about Global Witness. You might not be familiar with the organization. We are an international organization that seeks to expose and break the deep financial links that exist between corruption, conflict, human rights abuses, and environmental degradation. So our focus is primarily, but not exclusively, on the natural resource extraction industry. We work hard to investigate the dirty deals, and we follow the money to find those who are ultimately responsible. We publish thoroughly researched and documented reports, and then we use our findings to advocate for change. For example, you might know our work against conflict diamonds. If you've seen the movie Blood Diamond starring Leonardo DiCaprio, that's an example. So Global Witness is often described as an anti-corruption watchdog, and I'm a tax lawyer. So what is a tax lawyer like me doing in an anti-corruption organization? I joined Global Witness after years in international tax law practice, advising multinational corporations on tax compliance. And I'm here now because I believe that tax abuse is actually very closely connected to corruption. At the most basic level, corruption is likely a major driver behind bad tax policies. And we see this in the US through the relationship between campaign spending and misguided tax laws that benefit corporate campaign funders, for example. But there's also a bigger picture here that links these two issues, tax and corruption. And here I would like to avoid violent metaphors of, you know, stoning birds, et cetera, and try to take a more kind of medical approach. I would like to suggest that tax abuse and corruption are two very closely related, very similar diseases that share both underlying causes and symptoms. So to start with the causes, it's about human greed for sure, but not only. It's also about weak governance. That's what makes it possible. And there are really major enforcement challenges too in both areas of law. These two diseases also have very similar symptoms. Loss of public revenue, which all of us experience as a loss of public goods and services, whether it's roads that go unrepaired or schools that are underfunded. All of that might be avoidable if we can clamp down on and deter tax abuse and corruption. So how might we do that? Well, sticking with this medical metaphor, if they have shared causes and symptoms, I'm not a doctor, but it makes sense to me that they could also be treated by a similar prescription. And today I wanted to talk about one of the most promising prescriptions, ending anonymous companies. One of the founders of my organization, Charmian Gooch, recently won the TED Prize for our work on this issue. So what are anonymous companies? It's not a trick question. They are companies whose owners are not known, whether because the company is registered in the name of someone other than the true owner, or because the local corporate and banking law guarantees that the identity of the owner will remain secret. What Global Witness has learned through our investigations into corruption and state looting is that the easiest way to move money or to launder money, if you want to do it quietly, is to set up a company and then disguise the fact that you own it. And then you can use that company to open a bank account or to buy a fancy yacht, whatever you like. It's just like any other company. It really can do anything that any company can. But it's this element of secrecy that makes it a perfect vehicle for evading taxes. For example, HSBC leaks, which Jim mentioned, featured anonymous companies from jurisdictions including Panama, British Virgin Islands, Liberia, Samoa. All of those were used to facilitate tax evasion and avoidance that were involved in the HSBC scandal. And they were also implicated in a number of other Swiss bank scandals. Anonymous companies are also perfect for facilitating corruption. According to World Bank estimates, they are used in more than two-thirds of grand corruption cases. And it's more than tax and corruption. It's also drug trafficking, human trafficking. Really, anonymous companies are what unites all economic crimes, all crimes that generate money, because the secrecy makes it very difficult for investigators to penetrate. And to make it even harder, criminals sometimes set up a series of companies, like a chain of Russian dolls with one that owns another and so on, often across multiple jurisdictions all over the world, to make it all but impossible to figure out who is the ultimate owner. And then we have to keep opening this chain of Russian dolls, of shell companies, one after another, until we get to a real living and breathing human being. And this is called the ultimate beneficial owner. We have come up against this problem of anonymous companies a lot in our investigations, and one of our cases involves this gentleman. His name is Teodoro Nobiang. He is the son of the president for life of Equatorial Guinea, and also he serves as its minister of forestry. Equatorial Guinea, if you don't know, is a tiny country in West Africa with a deplorable human rights record, and its people are some of the poorest in the world. Yet their country is also rich in oil and timber and other natural resources. And oil is extracted by major American oil companies, among others. So where has all the oil money gone? Well, it appears in part to have ended up in the pockets of Mr. Obiang, who, according to the US Department of Justice, has spent more than $300 million on a playboy lifestyle, jet setting, acquiring luxury goods such as sports cars, celebrity memorabilia. And how did he do all of this on a modest government salary? One of his acquisitions is this $30 million mansion that's actually not very far from here in Malibu. It was acquired using an anonymous California company, which was called Sweetwater Malibu, named after the address of the mansion on Sweetwater Mesa Road in Malibu, if you might know where that is. And if you're in the market for something like this, that property is now on the market. After being seized by the U.S. government. Another of Mr. Obiang's acquisitions was a $38 million private Gulfstream jet, also acquired using an anonymous company, this time from the British Virgin Islands. And both the mansion and the jet were targets of US government forfeiture action under a new program established within the US Department of Justice called the Kleptocracy Initiative. After some lengthy legal wrangling negotiations with Obiang's lawyers, which happened to be LA-based actually, the parties reached a settlement where only the mansion but not the jet were seized by the government. There were also other assets that the Department of Justice tried but failed to seize, including Michael Jackson memorabilia, and that produced some amusing case names. For example, United States versus one Michael Jackson signed Thriller jacket, and United States versus one white crystal covered bad tour glove. But actually, Mr. Obiang managed to spirit these items out of the United States before the DOJ could get their hands on the Michael Jackson jacket and glove. So they are back in Equatorial Guinea. And one important clarification here, these were not criminal cases, which would have to meet the high legal standard of beyond reasonable doubt. So Mr. Obiang was never in any danger of spending any time in a federal prison. These were civil cases, which are normally easier for prosecutors to bring. And yet the government prosecutors met with quite mixed success. So I think that illustrates some of the difficulties of enforcing the laws that we have in this area. But another point is that Obiang didn't and really couldn't do this alone. He did it using services of global banks, including French and American ones, and with the help of lawyers and real estate agents, including some right here in California. And he also didn't do it in his own name. He hid behind anonymous companies. Now, I chose this example to highlight here, but really it's just one of the many cases that we have investigated over the years. I chose to focus on it not only because it kind of brings it closer to home, but because it highlights a couple of the misconceptions that people sometimes have in this area. One of them is it's all too easy to think of corruption as something that happened somewhere else over there and has nothing to do with us over here. So the Obiang case kind of brings that closer to home. But it's not just the West Coast. In the East Coast, you might have seen the recent New York Times series on prime real estate investments in Manhattan. Many of you have read it, but in case you missed it, I'll just give you the gist. The Times found that almost half of the most expensive residential properties in the US, so not just in Manhattan, but in the US, are purchased anonymously through shell companies. And it wasn't easy for them to find that. It took a team of seasoned New York Times investigative journalists over a year of hard work to pierce through these corporate shells and confirm the identities of the ultimate owners. And it turns out that many of these apartments are owned by foreigners, some of them with quite questionable pasts. Now, how could that be? Well, the real estate industry does very little examination of buyers' identities or backgrounds, and there's no law that requires them to do that. Another common misconception is that this type of secrecy is something that is only offered in sunny, small, tax haven islands somewhere in the Caribbean where you would go for a vacation, or maybe mountainous ones like Switzerland. But actually, in many ways, the situation is just as bad in major financial centers like the US and the UK. So a recent World Bank study found that the US was the favored destination for shell companies set up by the corrupt to move their dirty money. The second place was in the UK, including its overseas territories. And that's no surprise. Researchers from Australia found that many states in the US are among the easiest places in the whole world to set up an untraceable company, second only to Kenya. And in some states in the US, it turns out it's even easier to set up a company than it is to get a library card. You need less identifying information. The Obiang case is just one of the many examples we have uncovered where anonymous companies were used to move dirty money. And it isn't even the only one that involves California. That was also the place of choice for a former Ukrainian prime minister, among others. You can find these and lots more stories on anonymous companies in our new project, which we launched last year, called The Great Ripoff Map. It's an interactive map where you can click through to different regions and see the cases of corruption, tax fraud, all kinds of other crimes that have been committed using anonymous companies. We will continue to add stories to this map. It's very much a work in progress, and we encourage you to submit any stories that you uncover too. But this map is just the tip of the iceberg. In many of the examples in our map, the authorities did eventually catch up with the people who are responsible, but only after expensive, time-consuming investigations and court proceedings, which are required to peel away the layers of secrecy and to really uncover what's going on. For every case that has been exposed, there are just so many more that never see the light of day or that law enforcement has to drop because they hit a dead end. We know this very well because we talk to law enforcement experts, and it's also been our experience in our own investigations. But it doesn't have to be this way. There's nothing natural about this. And to quote Paul Collier, who is a prominent international economist, corporate opacity is not inadvertent. It is the cumulative achievement of the sustained effort of some of the most brilliant professional minds on the planet. So if it's not natural, it means it can be done. And we have already had successes in Europe, with the UK moving forward with the world's first public registry of beneficial ownership information. And now it's time to change the law in the US. We are calling for public registries of beneficial owners to help law enforcement in the fight against corruption, financial crime, tax fraud, financing of terrorism. And this isn't just about prosecuting criminals. We also want to prevent these crimes from happening in the first place. This needs to be done globally because it's a global problem and it calls for a global solution. As you've gathered, anyone can incorporate a company anywhere in the world. So every country should require a registry of the true owners of companies that can be accessed by anyone. That would enable people and companies to know with whom they are doing business. For example, before you sign a contract with a company, you might want to know that the real person behind it hasn't been indicted for fraud and isn't on the World Bank's debarment list. Public registries would bring the kind of transparency that allows citizens, journalists, businesses, customers, and civil society to demand accountability. It would allow us to hold companies, their owners, and our governments to account for the actions that affect each and every one of us. Thank you.
Well, thank you. One, two, three. Oh, yeah, we go. Thank you, Zorka. So let me start with you, Jim. Is a part of the problem that there is this commingling between multinational corporations, wealthy individuals, and criminals? In other words, it would seem that it's fairly identifiable where these havens are. So why can't we clean them up? Is it because there is, legitimate money, if that's the right word, along with criminal money commingled, and the legitimate lobby is, in a curious way, protecting the criminal lobby?
I think the legitimacy is in the eyes of the beholder, but there are some legitimate reasons I can think of for having an offshore company or trust, but at the end of the day, the balance is overwhelmingly in favor of cleaning them up. We've had a debate within the tax justice movement about how to do that. The United States is one of the most aggressive here, and we're not an offshore haven. But if you want to have a secret company, you can go to Nevada or Delaware. There's 900,000 companies in Delaware. Nobody knows who owns them. One of the leading lawyers in Panama, I asked him where he keeps his money. He said, well, confidentially, if I want to hide my money, I put it in Delaware, because there's just so many damn companies that nobody will ever be able to find it. There are some, commingling is going on, but I think there's pretty clear evidence that a lot of the justifications for offshore industry behavior just fall flat on their face once you examine them closely. For example, the argument has often been made that if it hadn't been for the existence of Switzerland, the Holocaust victims would have not been able to hide their assets in Switzerland. Well, in fact, the Holocaust victims, to a great extent, lost all the assets they parked in Switzerland. And you know, there are many more uses of offshore havens by dictators and repressors of human rights than we think are being used by, you know, the human rights victims themselves.
So, Zorka, the Obiang, the, from Equatorial Guinea, it was actually his son that had the mansion out here in Malibu. And I'm curious as to why the source of his money is mostly Exxon and Chevron, isn't it?
Well, that's a good question. As I mentioned, his official title is the Minister of Forestry. So that's a salary of about $8,000, and it would not have paid for the mansions and the jet and the Michael Jackson memorabilia, et cetera. So where the money came from is difficult to prove. And you see that from the outcome of the case.
But if he's selling oil and timber, and he's a huge supplier of oil to the U.S. or to American companies, where are the records of those transactions?
I think it's a great question.
I mean, can I comment on that?
Go ahead.
I had a meeting with Paul Wolfowitz when he was president of the World Bank. It was an odd meeting. He wasn't there long, and I wasn't there long either. But he, one of the people who was a key aide to him had been involved in an oil company. He was a Bush pioneer, and they were trading actively with Equatorial Guinea. So I went down to lobby the World Bank to get tougher on corruption, and here in the corner is one of the world's leading experts on Obiang. It wasn't from Chevron, but there's another Texas oil company involved in this case. So, yeah, the influence that many of these kleptocrats have within the policy establishment and within significant players within U.S. industry is phenomenal. That's why, to come back to your other question, why does this haven secrecy persist, you know, in the face of obvious remedies for it? Well, there's a powerful industry behind it. The haven industry consists of the world's largest banks, many law firms, many accountants, the leading accounting firms are in this up to their eyeballs, and there is no effective regulation of this industry. So it's a very lucrative business to not only to run a haven, but any particular haven could come or go. The industry finds new ways.
Well, because I was struck by the fact that the former head of the Nigerian Central Bank discovered there was something $30 to $50 billion missing from oil revenues, and instead of having an investigation, good luck, Jonathan, fired him.
He was fired. Yeah.
So that's an awful big vortex to suck up and disappear $50 billion.
No, absolutely. I mean, I think the Nigeria case you mentioned is a very interesting one, and it's an interesting place to watch now with good luck, Jonathan, being out of power, what will happen next, and how the future government will deal with some of those scandals will be very interesting to watch, absolutely. I mean, what is important is just to just start asking those questions. The proof, it can be really difficult to build these cases, especially criminal ones, you know, to establish proof beyond reasonable doubt, but just to kind of start asking the questions is the beginning of that process, even if the road to full legal accountability in a court of law is a very, very long one. Some of these courageous officials from like Governor Sanusi from Nigeria, who you mentioned, are very brave and really deserve our support.
So, Jim, I can understand why a big oil company would probably prefer to deal with a corrupt dictator than have to deal with a democratic country that has checks and balances and input from its citizens. You know, you could probably make a better deal with a crook. If it's just him and his family and not the people of the country that you have to, you know, who have to get the revenues. But So let's apply that same logic to the banks. The banks know these crooks that they're dealing with. They have this special desk. You were just pointing it out. The pirate banks, they have all this private banking services, and we know HSBC had a desk for a bunch of Mexican drug cartel people. So the banks know about the corruption, and in particularly when countries make loans like you were pointing out to Argentina in the 80s, they know that these are I guess they're underwritten or guaranteed by the US, and they're issued by private banks. They know all that money's disappearing, but they don't appear to care. So do they know they're going to get paid back? I mean, I'm literally trying to follow the money here.
Well, let's take the case of Citibank. Citibank was supposedly the largest lender to Latin America during the 1980s. In fact, they syndicated a lot of loans, but they sold them off to smaller banks. At the same time, they set up at that point, the world's largest international private banking department, very profitable, not on the books, sending bankers under the table to places. At that point, it was illegal for them to go to places like Mexico and Brazil and Argentina to take money out, but calling on the finance minister's family the same time that they're lending to the finance minister and helping to set up offshore accounts for him so he doesn't have to pay any taxes in Mexico. You could say that one bank at one particular point in time could have some bad apples. And that's the class. That's the typical thing that banks like Citibank or J.P. Morgan or HSBC now recently, UBS, Credit Suisse, every one of them, every time they get caught, they claim that there were some people in part of the organization that didn't realize that, say, in the case of HSBC, they were laundering $14 billion of Mexican cartel money. Or Wells Fargo, they claim that they didn't know that their exchange houses in Mexico were laundering $80 billion of cartel money. But when it happens again and again and again and again, and there is just no, there's kind of impunity for these institutions, you can no longer use that excuse. We just had the case of Credit Suisse in Washington. They had 700 bankers set up in a division beginning in 2000 to call on wealthy Americans. So this is the same activity that they were perpetrating against Latin Americans and third worlders back in the 1980s. It came back to haunt us, helping wealthy Americans take money to Switzerland, hide it tax-free. At least $20 billion, probably more like $50 billion that came from the United States paying no taxes. At the end of the day, that was a very profitable activity. No executives from Credit Suisse last May when they did the plea bargain went to jail. None of them were required to resign. They paid a $2.6 billion tax deductible fine. And they walked away from that whole activity. I've been arguing that the Department of Labor is now holding hearings on whether they should be allowed to advise U.S. pension funds as a bank. And it's been a big fight. We had Ralph Nader come and testify, and some of the Holocaust victims who've still to this day not been paid by that bank. But they hired John Podesta's brother to lobby the White House. John Podesta is now Hillary's key manager, but he was a counselor to Obama. He was counselor to Clinton back in the 1990s. And his brother has a very influential law firm. They also hire Covington and Burling, which was Eric Holder's law firm. And they hired every other lawyer you can imagine in Washington to influence this process. And at the end of the day, they got off with a slap on the wrist. That happens again and again and again to these major banks. So it is a political problem. It isn't a technical problem. And that's what we're up against.
Well, I'd be curious to know, though, what the role of the intelligence services are in all of this in terms of monitoring, because I know when in the Argentine case, Menem was such a crook, but the U.S. used Menem to secretly ship arms to Croatia during the war with Serbia and in the former Yugoslavia. And Menem was able to extract, you know, leverage that relationship, that secret relationship, to get a lot of loans, all of which either ended up in his pockets or his friends' pockets. I would have thought that the NSA must be monitoring all of these, like Nauru and the Cook Islands and you name them. There's so many of these havens. Wouldn't they be, you know, if according to Edward Snowden, you know, they, you know, have pictures of, I won't even get into that. I don't know whether you saw the thing on HBO, but they know everything about you. You know, you'd think that because money makes the world go round, they ought to be looking into these transactions. In other words, there doesn't seem to be a holistic picture of what's really going on. You provide us a glimpse into this underground world, which is vast and extraordinary, and the money is mind-boggling. Who's monitoring it? Is anybody?
Well, I have no particular insight into intelligence agencies, except my experience is that you know, there's kind of an oxymoron there. They're not helpful. They're not helpful. I mean, just think of the people you know who work for government institutions. There's just the same kind of lack of interest in really bringing this stuff. I mean, first of all, they don't see it as their role to expose and to criticize dictators. I think what they're interested in doing is exercising influence on people. You know, there's recently a case involving the president of Brazil and also Angela Merkel. The NSA had developed, reportedly, ability to tap their phones. And, you know, you could imagine how they would, let's say that they found out that the president of Brazil was receiving bribes from Petrobras, because she was chairman of the Petrobras board during the last 10 years. You know, in exchange for contracts, and there's a big scandal right now about that in Brazil. Well, if you were, you know, in charge of the intelligence effort there, you'd have a choice to make. Do we want to surface this and take, you know, basically help to remove her from office, or do we want to use the information in some other way? So I've got to believe that, yes, perhaps the NSA has all this wonderful data that I would just love to have, on all these shenanigans, but the odds that they will ever use it for consistent, constructive use is, you know, very small. There's no evidence that they've ever had it, and I assume that they've had it for decades. And you're talking about regime after regime after regime. You know, Pemex, another case in Mexico right next door. You know, they were missing oil in the 1970s and 80s to the tune of billions of dollars. And all of that was flowing into, you know, Lopez Portillo's offshore accounts. Did NSA ever, or, you know, the CIA ever decry that or even talk about it? Not at all. So we can't look to our intelligence agencies to clean this up.
Can I just comment on that? I agree that I think there's a long history of the U.S. kind of turning a blind eye to some of these major problems, especially in South America. But what we've seen in more recently, since 9/11, especially with the increased focus on terrorist finance and ways to battle it, is this linking of this recognition that the kind of secrecy that Jim and I are talking about is really something that enables terrorists. You know, they can kind of hide behind these secrecies laws, and there are discussions in Washington about how this secrecy is a national security risk. So perhaps it's just the beginning of a discussion, but it's there, and you know, I think that has the potential to change the conversation on some of these issues. That recognition that bank secrecy actually is something that helps our enemies. This is a relatively new element in the debate.
So we should try and get the questions up here too to start our Q&A. Go ahead.
I have a letter here from Henry Morgenthau. How many people know who Henry Morgenthau was? Good.
He's a Manhattan DA.
No, he was the
Secretary of the Treasury.
Secretary of the Treasury.
The son, the father of the...
May 29th, 1937. He's writing to FDR. And he's explaining why the tax revenues that the Treasury is collecting on the basis of the new 10% income tax, which is the maximum federal rate on the incomes greater than $25,000, married and filing jointly, was in 1937. Why the tax revenues from that were not what they expected. And he said, first of all, the device of evading taxes by setting up foreign personal holding companies in the Bahamas, Panama, Newfoundland. I didn't expect Newfoundland, but Americans have formed 64 such companies in the Bahamas alone in 1935 and 36. 22 more were organized by Americans in the Bahamas during the last 2 months. One American citizen with $3 million Bahamian corporation apparently attempted to prevent the Bureau of the Internal Revenues Service from auditing him by filing his individual tax returns successive years all over Canada. And he comes to the conclusion at the end of all this, and he goes through a litany of the same kind of behavior that you would see today with offshore companies. The ordinary salaried man and the small merchant does not resort to these or similar devices. The great bulk of our 5.5 million tax returns, that's 1937, are honestly made. Legalized avoidance or evasion by the so-called leaders of the business community is not only demoralizing to the revenues, it is demoralizing to those who practice it as well. So the point is that you know, these practices are long-standing, and secondly, they're not based on tax rates. You know, it's very hard to compete with zero, but some people, no matter what the tax rate is, will try to evade. All of the evasion that we're talking about having exploded since the 1980s took place during a period in which tax rates have been declining worldwide. And so it isn't tax rates that are driving this kind of evasion. It's the evasion that's driving the tax rates down through tax competition.
But we have also have a different problem in the United States, and that is that you've got the Tea Party Republicans who don't believe in government, and they're stripping money from the IRS in this latest budget. The IRS lost a bunch of money in the last budget, and they're losing even more in the next one. So that's crazy. I mean, the whole idea of tonight's forum is to figure out ways that all of this hidden money can be taxed and that people should be tax more fairly. This is, after all, tax day, and people are feeling the pinch here.
Well, I think one approach that Global Witnesses put forward on beneficial ownership is very constructive. I would also argue that we need other approaches as well. One would be to tax anonymous wealth. And you know, while we're waiting for the reform of our dreams to come along and have registries established everywhere, we should be generating some tax revenue based on the anyone who's not willing to come forward and declare, you know, we have a withholding tax on those folks and extract some revenue.
I would agree with that, but I think it's difficult to tax what you don't know is there. So that's part of the challenge. And I think that some of these transparency measures that we and Tax Justice Network and others are advocating for are really kind of a first step towards, you know, better tax enforcement, better anti-corruption enforcement. So I think it's related.
Let me start with a question here. If the catalyst of a euro-drachma collapse was to occur, and then the segue to a entirely digital, global, digital debt credit settlement system with perhaps a 15% flat tax in the cashier's society, would it, see these pencils are so faint, would we, I don't know, I can't read the rest of it, but and this is obviously an attempt to think about a technical or technological solution using digitized data. In other words, he's talking about a cashless society here. Is that a way out?
Well, in what lifetime? I mean, I think we have some, you know, immediate crises. The IRS budget has now been reduced to $8.7 billion from 10.9 in 2010. You know, we have that's less than the current DoD program for the F-35 fighter jet. You know, the IRS agents are literally can only answer 40% of the calls that are coming in. You know, and the productivity of the IRS is fantastic. It costs about $11.78 to do a mail audit per hour, and each hour spent on mail audits generates about $6,500. So, you know, there's just all the evidence in the world that we need tougher tax enforcement. We need tougher, support, I think, for a fundamentally democratic tax system that we've has been the pride of the world and is now falling apart.
Just to come back on this cashless, I gather that's what the question revolves around, going cashless, et cetera. I think that with respect to some of these, virtual currencies like bitcoins, it's turned out to be no different than cash, and can be used and abused as a way to kind of stash and launder dirty money. So I'm not sure I share this enthusiasm that I gather might be behind this question about whether going cashless is the answer to some of this. And the IRS is grappling with what to do with bitcoins, how to deal with it, because there is still, again, it kind of goes back to this problem of anonymity. There is a degree of anonymity there, and of course, that's why that's a big reason for the popularity of bitcoins and other virtual currencies. But you know, they still come with some of the same problems that we see in a cash-based economy.
So here's a question that, boy, this person in the audience really needs an answer. Is there any validity in the emails we get from a widow of an African general who just found me and wants to deposit $1 billion in my bank account?
Don't do it.
I think the safe bet to say the answer is no.
I think uniformly. I mean, it'd be interesting to take them up on it for a few minutes, but.
Are there any senators or congresspeople who are doing anything to stop tax dodging?
So we had, in the last Congress, we had, and for many decades, we had Senator Levin from Michigan, who was a great friend of tax justice activists. And we are very sad to see him go and to see him retire. But he was, I would say, the top champion of ending some of these abusive tax practices. And in particular, he had a bill called the Stop Tax Haven Abuse Act, which he reintroduced. But it's with the Congress, what it is, it's challenging to get it through. So one man or woman, we have hopes for Elizabeth Warren too. It's difficult to do that. So Senator Levin's bill has been taken up by some of the other Democratic senators, and we support it. We hope that those of you who are politically active can write to your representatives and support that bill. That would be great. It's called Stop Tax Haven Abuse Act.
So another question here. What are the top 2 to 3 actions big banks should take to stop money laundering?
Well, I think first of all, they should be responsible for the fact that there is money laundering, and they should.
There's a laundry, in other words.
They should. I think the track record is that the big banks are not going to do it on their own, and we need regulators who actually look at this issue a lot more forcefully in advance. I mean, the approach we've taken so far has been, very time consuming. It takes 5 to 8 years to bring a money laundering case against a major bank. The banks fight the cases, and by the time at the end of that, essentially they were betting back in 2004, 2006 that this activity would be profitable, and by the time they got caught up with it, on a discounted cash flow basis, the activity was profitable even after the fines. So it takes so long to actually go the prosecutorial route after the banks. It's so hard to find these cases and document them and then deal with the bank's resistance that, you know, actually that prosecutorial approach doesn't work. We need tougher regulation up front, and we need some banks that have been caught doing this stuff to actually pay the price of losing their corporate licenses, which has never occurred.
Where have the trillions of drug profits disappeared to?
I wish I knew the answer to that. It's from some investigations that was done not by us, but U.S. government agents. A lot of that actually was funneled through anonymous companies. So that was one of the crimes that I mentioned in my typology of economic crimes that are facilitated by these kinds of companies. And you know, it's just really difficult to trace. That's really the challenge. It's a major roadblock when it comes to drug trafficking as well as so many other categories. So, you know, they end up in companies that are maybe set up in, not even in offshore havens, but, you know, in these onshore havens, whether it's Nevada or Delaware, and then they are spent on, you know, luxury items. In the case of in one of these drug cases, the luxury item of choice turned out to be racing horses. So, you know, I guess everybody has a different thing thereafter. But the short answer is it's really difficult to get to the bottom of this without the kind of transparency that we are calling for.
So now, in the U.S., our infrastructure needs modernizing. Now that our infrastructure needs modernizing, there's a push for local government states/state to sell or to go into public-private partnership funding to accomplish the modernization. Does this work for you, and what can we do about it?
Well, this comes back to an earlier question about what the tax reform agenda is. There is no tax reform agenda right now. What we're going to be facing is a serious effort to repeal the corporate income tax, and if not to repeal it, to reduce the rate substantially. And even Obama has said that he would accept a substantial reduction in the corporate income tax rate. There's a proposal on the table from major companies to repatriate the $2.5 trillion they have offshore. As you know, if you know American companies that keep their profits offshore are not taxed until they bring them back, and they want to be able to bring them back at least 5-6% tax rate. On all the accumulated profits. First of all, they've been hyping the amount of profits they park offshore through these intellectual property games that they've been playing. And now they want basically a big break on all those profits. And Obama said, well, bring it back and let's invest in infrastructure. So that's how we come back to the infrastructure proposal. Infrastructure is a great idea, and there's a lot of cases, a lot of arguments for investing more heavily in public assets of all kinds, including infrastructure. You don't need taxes you don't need repatriation. You don't need to strip mine the federal corporate income tax in order to do that. It's just not essential. Right now would be a perfectly good, if you have rates of return, as people have calculated on infrastructure investments, of 30-40% real rates of return. There's, you know, been such little investment in public, in roads and highways and infrastructure in many places in the country, that the rate of return is very high. That can justify borrowing. If you have that kind of rate of return, it actually reduces the long-term debt ratio if you borrow now and invest in these higher return investments.
So here's a question that could get the questioner arrested. We actually had a Treasury official come into the green room earlier, but he's gone, so you're not going to get arrested. What's the best way to steal $10 million and launder it offshore under the assumption that I will have to flee to a country without an extradition treaty?
Wow. As I said, in my former life, I was a tax lawyer, but I never got a question like that. I'm not sure I can help with the first part about stealing the money. That's, you're on your own there. but when it comes to laundering the money, it is surprisingly easy. We actually have a publication that we put out called Idiot's Guide to Anonymous Companies. Not that I think that anybody here is an idiot, but it's just to show how easy it is. I encourage you to look it up, and that can give you some of the answers. If you really want to make sure that you get it right and that you're kind of, safe from the long hands of whichever law you're trying to flee, then yeah, you probably want to talk to a lawyer, and there are all kinds of lawyers that are standing by to really advise people like this. And some of them, really, there is one of the things I didn't mention in my talk is this responsibility of this kind of this enabling industry. I think Jim touched on it, the lawyers and the accountants, this kind of, financial industrial complex that makes all of this possible is really something that that should be in the spotlight a lot more in terms of the ethical and professional responsibilities of those professionals. You want to get professional advice. And, there's a whole army of professionals with questionable ethics that are waiting for clients like you. So,
Is there any consensus among countries for a worldwide tax system?
I'd say the answer is no, but we're working on it. That's one of the things the tax justice movement, which is now 50 countries and we're growing, I think, is trying to get. It depends on having citizens, first of all, educated about what's going on. I think not going to happen in Washington or in the Parliament in the UK or in any representative body that I can name, much less the kleptocracies of the world, to have these kinds of reforms. It's entirely up to us to build a citizens' movement the way we did in the 1890s and the first decade of the 20th century in this country, successfully demanding reforms, even in the face of impossible odds, even in the face of overwhelming political power in the hands of the elite. This is a class struggle. It is no easy way around that. It is not. It is a battle for democracy. It is a battle for political power. It is dependent on us to take back the power that money has acquired, and that is unavoidable.
Under Sarbanes-Oxley, surely the CFO of the banks, i.e. Citi, Wells, HSBC, etc., are liable for the fraudulent financial activity.
You would think so, but what we've seen in all of these bank prosecutions, they usually, actually almost always, all the ones that that I'm aware of, end in some kind of settlement. Often it's a deferred prosecution agreement or even a non-prosecution agreement where the bank kind of cuts a deal. Jim already described how this works and how the some of the fines are even not that huge to begin with, and then they're tax deductible. And any responsibility of individual officers is kind of, is swept under the rug. So some of these settlements that I've looked at really go to great lengths to actually avoid implicating or even naming any individual executives who would be responsible. And that's something that really it should be changed. It's not even a matter of changing the current law. Because there's Sarbanes-Oxley and some of the other relevant laws and regulations in this area. It's really a question of political will, including the Department of Justice. They have been criticized a lot for this problem of the revolving door, where people with who work at big private corporate law firms, come in and out depending on which administration is in power. So really, I mean, it is a big problem, and it's again, as Jim said, discussing the global tax system. This is also something that is primarily a political problem and not really a legal one.
What is the 1,000 year view on the classical optimal net tax rate? Actual tax rate versus effective tax rate, is 1/4 of income about acceptable to negate avoidance evasion schemes? I guess that's for the...
Well, I think, let me talk about contrast between successful countries and unsuccessful countries, countries that are struggling to develop. If you took, as I've done, and stratify countries by kind of income level and happiness, the average tax rate for the best, sort of the most successful developed countries is on the order of 25% to 35% of GDP. We've tried alternatives to taxation like privatization, debt, inflation finance, charity. At the end of the day, to be a developed country and to be a democratic developed country, you have an irreducible level of state expenditure that just has to happen for roads and highways and education and health and defense. And there's no way around that. Now, if you look at a country like Haiti and many low-income countries, they average something like 10 to 12% of GDP in terms of taxes. And most of that taxation is collected by VAT taxes or sales taxes or excise taxes that are very regressive. There is no successful example of a sustained developed democracy that has been able to survive without a strong state and a strong tax base. It just hasn't happened. So the question is not, it then becomes, how are we going to collect that 30 to 40% of GDP in order to be a successful developed country, to make those public investments we have to make? Are we going to do it on the backs of the poor and the middle class through regressive taxation, through the VAT type schemes that the Cato Institute favors for the United States? Or are we going to do it through progressive taxation? Because at the end of the day, I think the United States adopted the case, people from Teddy Roosevelt to Wilson to the founder of the American Economics Association, Richard Ely, everyone in the progressive movement originally adopted this, basically agreed with the argument for progressive taxation. It's just fair to basically have those who are best off and have benefited most from the country and its advantages to pay more as a share of their income.
Is the answer to this tax unfairness a taxpayer strike? Where Americans refuse to pay taxes until corruption and criminals are brought to justice?
Yes, that's a question for me.
Either way.
I appreciate where the question is coming from. It's in the spirit of Jim's call to arms, which was very, very powerful. But I'm not sure that would be effective. the IRS, underfunded as it is still does not take kindly to people who are, tax dissenters. So, I think the answer is really to try to change the rules. I know that seems really difficult and a long reach from where we are now, but I think that's the only way.
I mean, I agree with that. I think the best approach is the approach that there was a group called Tax Uncut, which got organized in 2011 around the Occupy time. And, you know, they weren't demanding, they weren't refusing to pay their own taxes. They were demanding that those people who can afford and should be paying taxes, like the 100 companies, that major Fortune 500 companies that pay no income tax. Citizens for Tax Justice has a thorough documentation of all these cases where major companies are just dodging taxes. It's important to demand that those folks do pay taxes. You know, there's no excuse for the fact that if someone has income from capital gains, that they pay a 17% rate or a 15% rate, whereas ordinary income earners basically have a 30 to 40% tax rate by the time you get done with state and local income taxes. So there's no excuse for that favoring capital. Those are simple demands that people should be able to make for reforms in the existing tax system. And we don't have to go on a tax strike to do that, because that's not the point.
So we'll have to make this the final question. Isn't the wealth inequality partially created by tax avoidance largely responsible for the broken U.S. economy?
Well, the IRS estimates the tax gap in the United States at $450 billion a year. We made a whole documentary called We're Not Broke, which is a Sundance documentary. It's on Netflix. You can see it.
Really great.
And it's about how we really don't have a financial problem. We have a tax dodging problem. And if companies would simply pay their fair share, a lot of the so-called deficit problem would be at not only the federal level, but also at the state level, would go away. So I invite you to look at that and educate yourselves about the realities of this thing. But the propaganda war has been waged to such an extent that a lot of people don't know, you know, how to think about these issues. And we have to really go back to brass tacks and pick up, you know, some of the information that's out there. Global Witness has a lot. You know, Tax Justice Network is another source. There are many other sources of information. But getting mobilized is first and foremost a personal act of education.
Well, I thank you both, Zorka and James, for coming out here, and I'm sure our audience appreciates it.